A very good afternoon to everyone, and thank you, Dr. Biswas, and the entire jury members for having me here.
Not Dr. Biswas, public prosecutor.
Public prosecutor, sir. So as you can see here is a 38-year-old lady who presented to us with a posterior polar cataract. And thanks to my proficient surgery and my great skills, I'm so happy I could remove the nucleus. I have done an IA and a multifocal lens has gone into the eye as well. So I'm breathing a sigh of relief and I'm just about to tell my assistants to switch on to the visco removal mode, and I'm thinking of where I'll take my daughter in the evening in the park. And that's when, just keep looking at what has happened. This is what we normally do for all cases. I'm putting my irrigation behind the IOL and the aspiration in front of the IOL. I start seeing something that's not really good. So what is this and when did it happen? So the first thing that I do, true to good surgical principles, I don't panic, I don't remove my instruments from the eye. I hydrate the side ports and the main incision. And I know that there is a big PCR with the IOL still in the bag, pretty stable here, a multifocal IOL, apodized diffractive one. So now to assess the damage, I have injected preservative-free triamcinolone acetonide into the eye and just washing it out to see the extent of vitreous. And yes, there is vitreous prolapse into the anterior chamber. Now at this point, I had two options. One is to just go in with two side ports that I already had and do a limbal anterior vitrectomy and just finish it off. But then what happens to the vitreous that is already coming through the PCR? So instead, I put a trocar cannula system in place and decide to perform a pars plana vitrectomy with the vitrector introduced through the pars plana opening and the irrigation through a separate corneal side port incision, and using a very low bottle height or intraocular pressure with moderately high vacuum and the highest possible cut rate that the machine could offer, I am performing an anterior vitrectomy. And as you can see, some of this vitreous is being drawn back from the pars plana vitrectomy approach. There is still some vitreous here at the incision, but the connections are being severed here. A very high cut rate in the cut IA mode. And the IOP is still very low because I don't want the anterior chamber to be too deep and the IOL to be pushed back a lot. So using good fluidic principles, I'm performing an anterior vitrectomy here just to demonstrate that it has to be a very thorough vitrectomy. Then the vitrector is brought out and then introduced through the corneal paracentesis, and whatever little vitreous was there in this area is also being cleared out. So now I'm sure and confident that there is no vitreous coming in from behind the IOL which could get incarcerated into the wounds or lead to traction, macular edema and the sequences. The IOL again looks pretty much stable in back. I had the option of considering what should I do, should I keep it or should I remove it? But I thought in my judgment that removing it would be a bigger mess in this situation because it looks pretty stable here. And there's a good central opening if you can see here with a small pupil. And this is how the case ended. And I'll just go on to show how she looks, the lady looked like on first post-operative day, a very well dilated pupil, quiet eye. And this is 1 week post-operatively, unaided vision of 6-9. And she is actually scheduled her second eye surgery next week. We go back and operate her. So that's my case, and I leave it here.
So shall I begin, sir?
Yes, sir, please. Sir, she's a very beautiful girl. Be a bit...
Yes, careful. And what she has done is an excellent demonstration of creation of the PCR. It was a nicely hypotonous anterior chamber. She went in and possibly she slept off. That was her 30th case. So there you are. She made that rent. Excellent creation, yes. A good teaching video for our juniors, for our fellows. Good. You made a second vitrectomy port. You know how to make vitrectomy ports. Why don't you make just one more and do a proper pars plana vitrectomy in such cases? Wait, you will have your chance. And the last thing, or the most important thing, you placed a multifocal in the bag with a large, irregular PCR. You show us the first post-op day, a week, and then immediately you tell the patient, you're happy? Patient says, yes, I'm happy. So next week, get this other eye done. Before that PC has opacified, that multifocal has shifted, and that patient is forever in agony with a multifocal that is decentered.
I think I should intervene now.
You may wait, ma'am. She can have a few words to say if she wishes.
Absolutely, sir. Dear sir, public prosecutor, so I do take your first comment that I probably slept off while injecting the IOL. I was too complacent, and that's when probably that initiation of the PCR had already happened.
Probably. And so you admit that you're guilty on the first accord?
I'm not guilty. I'm just a surgeon, and any surgeon can always have mishaps and mistakes.
So a surgeon can't be guilty. Do we take that?
At least I'm not.
I think I should defend her now instead of we listening to the vocal diarrhea of a solo prosecutor.
There are two more points if she wishes to defend them.
Absolutely. Now, the other point is, why did I not make a three-port vitrectomy and use a visualization system to perform a complete core vitrectomy? Two things. One, I'm not a trained vitreoretinal surgeon. I am primarily a cataract surgeon and anterior segment surgeon. So I don't find myself comfortable, especially in such a panic situation. This is not a planned vitrectomy. So where there is already a multifocal in the back, there's a PCR and it's a dicey situation. I'm not comfortable doing a three-port and messing it up more. Then the aim here is to perform a good anterior vitrectomy in the area, in and around the area of the PCR, and then obviously follow up the patient in terms of glaucoma, in terms of IOL decentration and retinal evaluation. The patient was told that your support is not as good as it should have been. And
still you should go in for the other eye.
No, that's the patient's choice. That we haven't told her. Okay. But she's being followed, and she has been told that in case there is a shift in IOL position, which is alarming,
we will re-implant a multifocal IOL.
We'll see about that, but at least we'll get this one out.
Honorable judge and esteemed jury on the dais, I think I should help my defendant before she's totally crucified by the public prosecutor. Don't we all agree this has been a textbook learning which he has shown us? It's always mandatory.
Accepted,
that
my lord. It's accepted. Yes. A very good.
No. Let her talk.
Listen, let me talk.
You are not allowing the lady to talk. Two pretty ladies.
So essentially,
you have to allow them to talk, prosecutor.
She has tried to go and remove the viscoelastic, the two compartment way of going in front and behind, and by chance she's had a posterior capsular rent. But the way she's gone about handling it, using a triamcinolone to remove the vitreous, and then when the PCR was large, could not be converted into a posterior capsular excess. The best way is to go behind to get the vitreous home from the posterior area. And she has looked, taken care of the pressure gradient issues beautifully. And more importantly, when you are doing vitrectomy close to its base, there's less traction. And because the way she has managed the whole thing, she was able to leave the IOL in the bag because the PCR had not enlarged. So what are we arguing here is, I think it's
objection,
so totally baseless, his allegations, and I think the judge should ask him to stop.
One question, one ethical question that an anterior segment surgeon must answer is, can we leave a multifocal in the bag after creating a large PCR and go over to do the other eye after a week, also with a multifocal? Ethical question needs to be answered by the jury.
So jury, what is your opinion about this question which he is bringing up?
Yeah.
Multifocal PCR.
No, I just wanted to ask Dr. Vaishali, what is the reason for the PCR, first instance?
The PCR, actually, when we went back in the video, it was a posterior polar cataract to begin with. So
yeah,
there is an inherent weak capsule. Fortunately, it didn't rupture until the entire lens material, including the cortex, was
out. I know.
But I suspect that there was some small rent, which we could see a small round dot after the IOL implantation. So during the IOL implantation, possibly there was less viscoelastic in the eye, and that stressful implantation injured the PC, and then the fluidic force of the IA when the irrigation was behind the IOL caused it to enlarge.
No, you have the irrigation behind the IOL and the aspiration in front.
In front.
Why don't you have it the other way? In posterior polar cataract, what I do is, I have the irrigation in front and the aspiration behind. So what happens is, it will push the posterior capsule and you can have a cleavage there, you can go in, especially in a posterior polar cataract. I would like to do that.
Second thing is,
when you do a pars plana vitrectomy, anterior vitrectomy, you've done a very good job. Only thing is, the probe is facing up. The probe has to face sideways because you don't want to take the posterior capsule which is already there, because that is only supporting that particular lens. So I saw that the port is facing up.
Upwards.
Yeah. The port is facing up. What happens is, along with the anterior vitreous, there is a possibility that you can chew up the posterior capsule as well.
Yes, sir.
So these are the two points I wanted to mention.
Otherwise, the jury member is making. I'll ask Dr. Vasavada to donate also one femtocataract to you soon, sir. Please support her. But so jury,
one question.
What do you say? Guilty or not guilty?
One question. See, with regard to the planning, you said it's a posterior cataract.
Yes, sir.
Were you right in planning a multifocal when there was a possibility of PC rent and that too, like, you know, now
so
you have to commit
is,
the other
do you put
end.
Multifocal you? In posterior polars?
In terms of planning, one thing.
Second is
in terms of planning intraoperatively. As Mohan said again, do you think it was a mistake on your part to go behind it?
I think there are two issues here. One is, would you talk to the patient or would you plan a multifocal in any situation, polar or a cataract where you expect a PC defect? Well, we do tell the patients if they are suitable otherwise for a multifocal. We give them an option of multifocal. If they go for it, there is always a caveat that intraoperatively, if we find before putting the IOL that your posterior capsule or your support is not good enough to harbor the multifocal, even if you wanted one, we will not put one. So. Yes, absolutely. I did. Actually, when I put the IOL in, I was very confident. So another lesson that I learned, a big lesson, is that in posterior polar cataracts, even the smallest step is very important.
I think now we will ask the jury straight away for the decision. Yes, jury, please.
Dr. Mohan Rajan.
All.
Yay! Oh, what is this, sir?
Madam, there is only one objection. What about Agarwal Hospital? We also don't have. Madam, congratulations. Okay, next time when you don't have PCR or you have PCR, create PCR and do multifocal glued IOL.
Of course I'll do that. Of course I'll do that.
Thank you.